let me tell you the bad news first. The bad news is that in this world, everybody wants to be happy, right? Everybody wants to be happy, but very few people find happiness. That's a fact, okay? You can go to China or anywhere in the world, most people want to be happy. Your kids, your old people, I'm happy, right? But they don't know how. Do you know how to find happiness? Do you know how? Let me tell you the truth. I spent 40 years doing research on that, okay? But the truth is a tough truth, okay? It's not easy, okay? The first lesson is a happy life is a matter of making the right choices. That's the first principle. Making the right choices, right? So I don't have a choice of going out or stay here. You've got a choice. Oh, you don't make a choice, eh? Okay, your mother made a choice for you, eh? But it's a good choice. Let me tell you why, eh? Sometimes, one wrong choice can ruin your life, and one reluctant choice can save your life. Okay? The challenging part is that the less traveled path is often your best path. Have you heard that before? Hey, young man? The less chosen path is often the right one. That is number one. Choosing the less traveled one. Do you know why? The less traveled one is often the meaningful one, lead to happiness and meaning. The expedient one, the broad way, lead to self-destruction. The broad way that everybody's choosing, okay? Now here's my friend, Jordan Peterson. Have you read him? Principle rule number 7. Choose what is meaningful rather than what is expedient. A meaningful one is often the narrow and straight path of sacrifice, of the cross, of going uphill the Calvary Road. The broad way is the fun, an easy ride, easy rider, having fun. Not boring, excitement, getting drunk, play games, play a ton of games all day, all night. And the Broadway is the way of the least resistance, the easiest way, the most convenient and advantageous, but eventually leads to self-destruction. Okay, watch it now. This is for young people, okay? This is okay. Suicide story for young people. What's going on? Their parents provide good hope for them. They give them money to buy anything they want. You know, recently, the Chinese young man had 3 expensive cars in the garage, $300 each. He got so bored with life. You know what he did? He paid money to kidnap him. Do you know that? He actually paid money to kidnap him to create some excitement. How sad it can be. They're suicide. You know why? Because they expect life to be fun, life to be happy, life to be easy. But there isn't anything inside them, the inside is hollow. So whenever they get from difficulty, if they didn't go to school, mom would say, go to school. Or commit suicide. And all they say they want to produce drugs or whatever. Or whenever difficulty happens, they don't have anything inside them to cope. They collapse. But their life is so shallow. So shallow, so empty. So by pursuing happiness, end up addiction, depression, and suicide. It is self-destructive. So the main path is a narrow path, okay? Now, you'll be surprised. Many years ago, I did an experiment, big experiment. I go all over the place, ask people, if money is not a problem, if money not even have all the money you need, how will you spend your day? Okay, this is a fair question, right? Because so many of my, I've seen many young people and my clients, okay? Because they have all the money, they do all the money, but they're bored with debt, they don't know how to spend it, their life. My question is that, if all the money, how do you spend your time? What do you do? You play game all day, you'll be bored with debt. You're drinking all day, you'll be hangover. So the question is, what do you do with your life? You pay money to kidnap you? Because of my excitement? What do you do with your life? So I surveyed many people in Vancouver. Guess what? The collective wisdom, relationship, achievement, justice, acceptance, faith. Wow. All these things require sacrifice and dedication. Can you have a happy marriage with the hard work? Can you have a happy marriage with a sacrifice? No. Can you be an accomplished pianist with a sacrifice? Hard work. Can you be a successful scientist, or lawyer, or anything? Is it possible for you to achieve excellence in any area? No. Sacrifice and hard work is a narrow path. If you're not willing to do the hard work, have a disciplined life, and pursue an ideal, and making sacrifices, you'll never find meaning. Okay? And justice, being fair. In the jungle, you know, the alpha male, the beast that is strongest, beating everybody else, oh, he can everything. But in a civilized society, evolution has worked such a way that they figure out it's not a good idea to beat up everybody else and get everything yourself. So it's not a way to produce a stable society. So they began to, a civilized society with brain, they began to develop, it's better for us to develop some rules so why would be fair to people, right? Our society tried to create laws that before the law, we're all equal. But that's a civilized way of doing things, okay? So let's be fair with each other. So them can happy work, happiness. And the third point, fourth point, that you got to accept your imperfection. I have to accept the fact that I'm short and ugly. And someone is you're tall and handsome, right? So like rubber, right? Some tall and handsome. Oh, Mr. Virtual, right? Hey, Mr. Virtual is a good, handsome guy, eh? So I'm sorry, I'm old and skinny and short and ugly. So I accept that behavior. No, I'll be speaking in South Africa virtually. The top is shame. One type of shame is ashamed of my body image, but I'm not going to be willing to spend money to my practice or surgery. There are many people who spend a lot of money to make them look good. They are ashamed of their look. You have to accept yourself to be happy. You have to accept yourself. You can't do that. Forget it, okay? The last part, I faith. Last week, I was counseling a Chinese woman. She really worried about her son. her son is smart and good looking, but miserable. And she herself is, because of her son, she's miserable. And she make her smart, make her husband miserable. So the whole family is miserable because her son is miserable. So I mean, what can I do? I say, the more you do for your son, the more he will resist you. I said, she's not resisting you. She'll close the door when you come home because she's afraid. He's afraid of you. Keep on bothering him. Now you see the result. Now you're reaping the result. I'll keep on controlling yourself. Then she said, what can I do? I said, leave alone. But I can't leave him alone, he can hurt himself. I said, then trust God, pray for him. I said, but my country said that my country don't believe in God. China, yeah. My country don't believe in God. But I said, who says so? In China, 5,000 years history. All we talk about Hu Tian, crying out to God, crying out to Sky God. The sky has eyes. Sheng Tian Yu Yan. China, all through 1,000 years, they cry out to God, the people cry out to God, but they're desperate. The Chinese say, Gou Ji Tiao Qiang, Zeng Ji Hu Tian, a desperate dog would jump over a wall. A desperate people would cry out to God. Human nature. I said, you try to pray, you see what happened. You're not gonna lose, I said. You either worry about yourself, everything miserable, or pray to God. So I challenged her, just last week. I challenged her, I said, trust me, science and proof. That faith is a very powerful thing. Not faith is a powerful thing, but self-transcending, you know? Forget yourself helping other people. You always think about me, my son, my family. You'll be miserable. The whole life you wrap around your son. Because son is her God. The one child policy in China. The son is the God. Xiao Huangdi, little king. The whole family will revolve around the son. So, all these things, they're meaningful, but require sacrifice and dedication. Okay? Here I talk about PD, okay? Anybody in nursing or medicine, you're in medicine. And you're in medicine, okay? Do you know? For medical doctor, working with older people, palliative care. With people, cancer patient, with palliative care. Those people, they're dying. The world is shrinking to a little bed, hospital bed. That's all they have. In order to call dignity therapy, in order to restore some dignity to the patient, you have to believe. Believe there is a transcendental, invisible reality. They believe that life has dignity, life has value. To a good doctor, to a good nurse, you have to believe that. Otherwise, oh, he's so sick, let him die. Or some nurse, give injection, kill him. Useless, he's lying there, useless. Kill him. You can't do that, right? You can't do that. So to be a good medical doctor, to a good nurse, you believe that there is a invisible transcendental reality, there are transcendental values, like Zheng Shai Mei, truth, beauty, and goodness. Those are invisible. but real. And quantum physics says that what you see is real is not there, because it's all energy. It's all energy. So the invisible is more real. Okay? And also, the dignity of human life. Every life has intrinsic value and dignity. Do you know why? Because we are all created in God's image. You know why? Because we are all capable of growth. We all have loved ones. We all have loved ones. Every single person is the son of somebody, the father of somebody, the husband or wife of somebody. Everybody is valued by somebody. So every life has intrinsic value. So this belief makes you happy. Even with one of those beliefs, when tragedy hits you, you collapse. Okay. When everything's going away, I was fine. But sometimes good things happen to bad people and you collapse. Okay. No. The Broadway, the pressure, there's a TV a series about decadence. Money, power, sex, pleasure. Yeah. They have everything. Self-destructive. In the sixth episode of that documentary, they talk about the people who choose religion, who choose meaning. Now, last week, that's a group of nine come from PI to look for me. So they want to learn from me about meaning therapy. Now, look at faces. Are they happy? Two of them give up their PhD in psychology. Give up their PhD in psychology from a nun. And that two person also higher educated. Look at their faces. Are they happy? Eh? Do you want to be like them? Do you want to be a nun? Do you want to be a monk? Nothing. Eh? And I see some children become nuns, monks. When I was speaking in Taiwan, some nuns, some monks are very young. But they're happy. They give everything, they're happy. Look at their faces. And look, most of the people I see in the subway, in the mall, they all look so sad. They're worried about something, they look rational, you know, they're worried about something. Look at the faces. Do you want to be like that? Eh? But the way of faith, then happy man can be Christianity, can be Hinduism, can be anything that directs focus away from yourself, away from the world, to something transcendental. In Hong Kong, okay? And then Broadway. Now this is an interesting story. China wants to create an orderly, secure society. You have a happy life if you follow the leader, Chinese Communist Party. You follow the leader, everything will be fine. But the catch is, you follow the leader, then you don't have the freedom to worship, freedom to speak your mind. So that's why you sacrifice. But within China, millions of people are happy to give up that freedom in return for security, right? The trade-off. I gave up my freedom in order to have a good life, secure and happy, prosperous life. But people in Hong Kong, so used to British democracy, so they choose to protest. They sacrifice their own future by fighting for a greater future, a greater good of the future of Hong Kong. Now they interview they interview a rich a publisher, Jimmy Lai, Apple newspaper. They say, you lost millions of dollars of advertising because China forbidden companies to advertise in a newspaper. So you lost millions of dollars, and your life is being threatened. Why do you protest? Gilbert said, I protest, I sacrifice for something for the future of Hong Kong that gives me a sense of meaning. See, look here. I protest, I sacrifice, that gives me a sense of meaning. The young people say that we lose everything, we sacrifice. And my young man read his video on TV, he said that my dear mother, my girlfriend, when I go out to protest, I might be killed. It's real, the bullet. I might be killed. So I want to read his will. But I still want to protest because that gives me meaning. See? Again, it demonstrates that whether it's in the West or in the East, the path of meaning is always a more narrow and more risky way. The broad path, you can get security, prosperity, but you're stopping yourself, okay?